Here again, Mr. Independent Lou Dobbs.
The Obama administration is considering deploying up to 80,000 additional troops to Afghanistan, but the top U.S. military commander in Afghanistan, according to reports by the Associated Press, is warning that even with those additional troops, up to 80,000 more, corruption in the Afghan government itself could undermine any possibility of a victory in the fight against the Taliban and Al-Qaeda. Given the lack of a clear objective and strategy for our military in Afghanistan, should our troops be, in fact, pulled out and brought back home? That is the subject of our face-off debate tonight. And joining me, Stephen Biddle. He's Senior Fellow for Defense Policy at the Council on Foreign Relations. He is a member of General McChrystal's Strategic Assessment Team. And David Ritgers, Legal Policy Analyst at the Cato Institute. As an Army officer, he served three tours in Afghanistan. Good to have you gentlemen with us. Thank you for being here. Let me turn, if I may, first to Steve. You testified before the House Armed Services Committee today, and if we may, I'd like everyone to hear part of what you said.
I want to focus, however, on what is arguably the most fundamental underlying question. Is the war worth waging, and at what cost? And it seems to me that the answer to that question in the short form is that the case for waging war in Afghanistan is a close call on the analytical merits.
A close call. What would be determinant in your judgment for our commander-in-chief in making that determination as to how to proceed?
In a situation where it's a close call on the merits, it turns on a value judgment. How much are you willing to pay to reduce the risk to American security by how much? That's not an analytically determinant question. For me, I draw the value judgment as it being worth doing this, only barely so, but worth doing this, and if we're going to do it all at all, I think we should do it in a way that has the best chance of succeeding in it. But it's a value judgment that reasonable people will differ on.
And reasonable people certainly do. Why is it your judgment that the president will not even consider, given that it is a close call, withdrawing our troops?
Well, I obviously can't speak for the president, and I want to emphasize, I'm only speaking for myself. I'm not speaking for General McChrystal, the headquarters staff. I actually think that it is a viable option. At the end of the day, it's not the one that I think is stronger, but I do think it deserves serious consideration.
Well, thank you. David, you served three tours in Afghanistan. You have a experiential knowledge of both the conflict and the country. You don't agree that sending more troops to Afghanistan is worthwhile. What leads you to, and I compliment Steve for being candid in the close call, what is the tipping point for you?
Well, I think the key thing is that this is a struggle for legitimacy, and we cannot create legitimacy by adding troops, and Karzai's writ must extend, or whoever the president is, must extend beyond Kabul by virtue of legitimacy with his population, and we don't fix that with extra troop numbers.
If what is there in this, and I'm going to ask this of both of you, and Steve, I'll start with you. What is there in this in which the American people have been told by commanders, including General David Petraeus, to be prepared for counterinsurgency, long wars, whether it be Iraq, whether it be Afghanistan, or in other conflicts? Why is there a mindset in the general staff that has been unable to, empirically, to deliver success in 8 years in Afghanistan? Why is there a mindset in the general staff that the American people should be tolerant of quote-unquote long wars, and why should the American people be tolerant of conflicts in which the United States does not bring to bear its technological advantage rather than put forward troops and engage troops in combat that would be unnecessary if the United States were prepared to save those lives and to limit the cost in lives and limbs and blood in favor of that technological advantage being deployed and carried out on the battlefield?
Well, if technology could solve this problem, I guarantee you that the U.S. military would prefer that solution. The trouble is this form of warfare is one which is unusually resistant to high technology solutions. The heart and soul of counterinsurgency is whether or not you can protect a civilian population from the depredations of the insurgents. The insurgents are dressed in civilian clothing. concealed in and among the population itself. That's not a problem that we can solve from 30,000 feet with a precision-guided bomb. It requires people on the ground able to persuade the civilian population that we will protect them so they can tell us safely who the insurgents are and who the innocents are. If that's a problem we could crack with better equipment, I guarantee you we would do it. But I don't think anyone knows how to do that.
Dave, your thoughts?
Well, I think that if we look at the way that Afghanistan's population is spread so thinly across the entire country, a country both more populous and larger than Iraq, the number of troops we would have to use to achieve the goal of securing the entire Afghan populace, we're looking in the order of 200,000. So I think that we need to tie our resources to a more realistic goal, which is deterring Al-Qaeda from attacking us from those areas. That's what we went there to do, and if we're going to have a mission there, that's where it should remain.
And with the issue that the Karzai government is corrupt, and that corruption, by the way, as you suggest, Dave, extends well beyond Kabul. It is nationwide. It is, in fact, endemic and pervasive corruption. It is even a way of life, one could argue, in Afghanistan. What is the national objective here, if we can anticipate the president by a few weeks? What is the national objective here that cannot be achieved by some other means rather than the loss of lives, limbs, and blood, all American?
Well, that's a good question, and that's why I think we have to take a hard look at what is the value added of whatever it is, 40,000 or 80,000 troops that we can't achieve with a moderate footprint until the Afghan government grows to the capacity that it needs for its internal legitimacy.
Steve, you get the last word here tonight.
Well, I think our interests in the country are quite clear. They're not unlimited, but they're quite clear that Afghanistan not become a base for attacking us and it not become a base for attacking Pakistan, its neighbor. Pakistan is a nuclear-armed country with an ongoing insurgency within its borders and an Al-Qaeda base located right there. The risk to the stability of Pakistan, which is a clear vital national security interest of the United States, if the government in Afghanistan collapses and we get chaos on the other side of the Durand Line, goes up substantially. That is, I think, an important U.S. interest in the conflict. It's indirect, it's not unlimited, but it is important. And I think it's worth effort to try and secure.
Thank you very much. We appreciate it. Dave, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. Up next.